Before we look into the controversy generated by the partial release of the Henderson Brooks-Bhagat Report, it is necessary to understand that the committee itself was mandated to look at only the operational aspects, and therefore when it puts the blame on the military establishment and the intelligence apparatus, that would be the case because that was the mandate of the committee. It doesn't say a word about the political establishment. Now, much has been written about in books, journal articles, as well as papers about the role of Nehru and what was his understanding of China. But it is not exactly clear how that flawed understanding of China percolated into the actual China policy. And I'll give you three specific examples where this flawed understanding of China percolated into the actual policy making. Between 1956 and 1962, India increased its defense expenditure from $403 million to $608 million by 1962. However, most of the defense spending was geared towards meeting the threat from Pakistan, which was what Nehru believed would be the primary security threat. However, after achieving a military supremacy over Pakistan, Nehru was content and did not look at meeting the Chinese challenge. As a result, the Indian Army was at the receiving end of this broad understanding of the Chinese threat, and it affected its operational preparedness. For instance, to meet the Chinese challenge, Army needed mountain warfare equipped battalions, and a proposal for this had been mooted way back in 1947, but the proposal never reached its logical conclusion because of political disinterest. Secondly, looking at the expansion of the Assam Rifles, the Himat Synergy Committee report had suggested reorganization and expansion of the Assam Rifle units, but this exercise was never undertaken in a serious manner, and therefore by 1962 we had only one division of the Assam Rifles being deployed at the Himalayan border. Complacency looking at the Chinese threat was particularly evident in the deployment of the army divisions. Now, we had 9 divisions being placed on the Himalayan border, but all of these divisions were not in full strength, and what's more, they were short of the artillery, the equipment, and even basic clothing. Therefore, these divisions were there only to mark India's presence, but they were never able to withstand a full-scale Chinese aggression. A manifestation of the problematic understanding of the China threat was also evident in the way the Ministry of Defense bureaucracy processed the demands coming in from the Indian Army for the new equipment and weapons platforms. So, preference was given by the bureaucracy for Army's demand for tanks and other equipments because the bureaucracy thought that these will play a major role in the India-Pakistan war. But any demand coming in from the Army to meet the Chinese threat was not given seriousness by the bureaucracy. Perhaps more ominous was the fact how India looked at the road building activity of the Chinese, particularly in the Aksai chain area. Now, the Henderson Brooks-Bhagat report talks about the fact that Indian government was aware of the Chinese activities on road building in the disputed area, but never paid any attention, and it was only by late 1950s and early 60s that we raised the issue with the Chinese, but by that time it was too late. Now, looking at the present controversy generated by the Henderson Brooks-Bhagat report, it is important for us also remember that we really have to resolve the differences within the government on how to look at China. There is one section of the bureaucracy which takes a very dim view of China, while on the other hand, there is a section of the bureaucracy which takes a favorable view of China, looking at China as a partner. And therefore, that impairs an effective implementation of the China policy. Going forward, the government needs to resolve both the competing viewpoints and maintain a very effective China policy. And this report has also brought out another interesting aspect, which is India's dismal record in releasing and declassifying critical national security archival material. Access to this kind of material is very important for the scholarship and analysis purposes because it can be give different interpretations of the same event, which will enhance our understanding of what went wrong during the past and how we can gear up for the future.